Hi friends, welcome to the NPTEL course on Leadership for India Inc. Practical Concepts and Constructs. We are in week 2, we discuss leadership theories. In this lecture, we talk about trait theory. What is trait? Trait is a particular quality of a person which is distinct and distinctive to the person. And trait is part of a person's personality. And what is personality? Personality is a cluster of the qualities that a person possesses. So let's try to define leadership. Having gone through several aspects of leadership and management in the previous week, let's try to focus more sharply on leadership. There are two views of leadership. One, I would say, is the internal team view, and the other is the external stakeholder view. We can also call the second view a broader ecosystem view. So when we talk about the internal team view, I would say that there are four parameters that define leadership. The first, of course, is the leader. The second is the team. Third is the processes. And fourth is the goals. So leader is the personality that is capable of influencing people. Team comprises individuals who are brought together to accomplish certain goals. What are processes? Processes are those interconnected and interactive activities that are expected to be done by the team. Goals are the outcomes that both the leader and the team members together and in an aligned fashion want to accomplish. This is the internal view of leadership. Then there is a broader external view, which I would call the ecosystem view, because the stakeholders for a leader are far greater in number than just employees. Employees are, of course, one very key operational stakeholder group. But we also have financial stakeholders who provide the capital for the firm. These are the banks, financial institutions, investors, etc. Then we have the operational stakeholders. In this group, employees obviously are the primary ones, but equally important are vendors, suppliers, dealers, and customers. Then we have got regulatory stakeholders, central and state governments, national and international bodies, etc. We also have the promoter stakeholders. In several cases, when the enterprises are set up by founders, we also have the promoter stakeholding group, which has got an important stake in how the firm is run. So whether the leader comes from the promoter group or the leader comes from the professional group, he or she needs to satisfy all these stakeholders. Once an integrated view of both the internal as well as the external view of leadership is taken, the complexity of leadership becomes very apparent to us. Every team member of an organization will have some connectivity or the other with every other team member. Similarly, every stakeholder has some direct or indirect connectivity through the firm and with the firm to accomplish the expectations. And that's the complexity of leadership. And leadership involves not merely directing certain people to do a few things, not even engaging with and interfacing with all these stakeholders, but influencing the team members and the stakeholders in a manner that the overall goals of the company are achieved seamlessly. So what are the theories of leadership? Over the last several decades, several theories of leadership had emerged, partly with a view to conceptualize and define leadership, and partly with a view to enable managers and aspirants to acquire leadership capabilities. We can think of at least 7 leadership theories which were there in both theory and research over several decades. The first and the foremost is the great person theory. That was the earliest theory, and it corresponds to the period of 1840s, when it was theorized that a born leader is the leader, or inversely, a leader is always born. Then came the trait theory, which is the focus of this particular lecture, which is a personality characteristic approach of 1940s. So a century down the road, after the first institutionalization of the great person theory took place, we have the trait theory, which is a personality characteristic theory of the 1940s. Then we have the behavioral theory, which is a style-oriented approach belonging to the 1950s. Then came the situational theory, which said that leadership is very contextual and situational, and it belonged to the 1990s. We also have the path goal theory, which is a work-oriented approach, which belonged to the 1970s. leader member exchange theory, which is a dyad based approach. Dyad means a dyad of leader and the team member. That's the approach that belonged again to the 1990s. But today, when we look at leadership, we talk extensively about skills, competencies, philosophical approaches, which is a hybrid contemporary approach, I would say, for 2000s. The several theories of leadership as above point out the challenges and inadequacies of attempting to frame leadership into singular frameworks. The very fact that there are as many as 7 leadership theories, although across generations, it also implies that leadership defies easy definition. Some of the leadership frameworks are no longer relevant, as we will see as we progress through this, but it is important to review them along with the more recent ones so that we have a holistic appreciation of the various theories of leadership. Now let's look at the great person theory that was proposed by Thomas Carlyle in the 1840s. It merely believes that leadership is genetic. A leader is born, and such leaders have their intrinsic leadership capacity, and when the occasion asks them to do, they rise up to the occasion and belong to that leadership category. So we have Chhatrapati Shivaji, who is the valiant type of the great person. Then we have Jhansi Rani Lakshmibai, who was ordained to fight the Britishers and then try to establish Indian independence. Then we also have expansionist opportunities and expectations which drive some people to leadership, Alexander the Great. So whether it is the valiant nature of the individual, the ordained nature of the circumstance, or the expansionist motive of the leader, a great person who belongs to this theory rises up to that particular opportunity and becomes a leader. However, this philosophy or the proposition that the ability to lead is inherent genetically, I would say, is faulty. It is no longer relevant. Much of that theory is very much military driven and very much gender oriented. Although, of course, we have this excellent case of Jhansi Rani Lakshmibai being a gender agnostic leader. But the great person theory, in my opinion, has no relevance in contemporary times, which discourage genetic lineage as well as monarchies, even when existent monarchies are just titular. So let's look at the trait theory. So at this point, I would like to say that while I have provided a lot of information on the various leadership theories, if you want to go into that in greater detail, you could probably refer to this book on leadership by Nordhaus, which provides a very good summation. And it is a good summation with a lot of detail about the various kinds of theories. However, for the purpose we have of this course, I would think that whatever I have presented in terms of the details would be more than sufficient. Trait theory represents one of the most systematic approaches to study leadership. Several scholars made attempts to identify traits that would be there in a typical leader and then distinguish the leader based on the traits with other individuals. While the trait approach was questioned from time to time, even today, leadership traits are of very much importance. Ralph Stadgill was the professor who was a pioneer in the trait theory. He did 2 meta-analyses, one in 1948 and another in 1974. In the 1948 survey, he had analyzed 124 trait studies between 1904 and 1947. In the 1974 study, he undertook a meta-analysis of another 163 trait studies, which happened between 1948 and 1970. He proposed, based on his studies, that a successful leader's traits are relevant to the demands of the leadership situation. That is, the specific challenges faced, specific opportunities faced, the hopes, values, and concerns of the followers. That was the essential approach which Stockdale took. In the first trait survey which he undertook, based on the 124 trait studies, he analyzed and came up with 8 important traits. These are intelligence, alertness, insight, responsibility, initiative, persistence, self-confidence, and sociability. Such traits we will relate to the leadership paradigm even today. However, what he said was important. He said that an individual does not become a leader simply because he possesses those traits. However, those traits must also be contextually relevant for the leader to become the real leader. A leader in one situation need not necessarily become a leader in another situation, even if having these traits, because leadership is conceptual. Stockdale's 1948 study, which was focused on identification of leadership traits, has also led to the beginning of a new research which is based on the situational nature of leadership. Correlation between leadership behaviors on one hand and leadership situations on the other hand began to be researched. Let us look at what his second trait survey, that is the 1974 study, which had 163 new studies meta-analyzed. What did it bring out? It said that the drive for responsibility and task completion, vigor and persistence in pursuit of goals, risk-taking and originality in problem-solving, the drive to exercise initiative in social situations, self-confidence and sense of personal identity, willingness to accept consequences of decision and action, readiness to absorb interpersonal stress, willingness to tolerate frustration and delay, ability to influence other people's behavior, and the capacity to structure social interaction systems to the purpose at hand. The second meta-analysis led to these 10 factors, as being very important for leadership. As you can see, compared to the first trait study, this involved more elaborate description of traits and situations. This study as well reinforced the thesis that a leader's characteristics are certainly part of a leadership but need to be interpreted in terms of the organizational leadership situation. Now let's try to combine these two and analyze through a compare and contrast study. The 1948 study, as I said, talked about intelligence, alertness, insight, responsibility, initiative, persistence, self-confidence, sociability. The 1974 study talked about similar but not necessarily all these factors. It talked about achievement, persistence, insight, initiative, self-confidence, responsibility, cooperativeness, tolerance, influence, and sociability. So what I did was that I looked at the factors that were common across the two studies and factors that were discrete. So when you look at these factors, you'll find that insight, initiative, self-confidence, sociability, responsibility, and persistent, these are the common factors. That is, across a particular generation movement, these leadership factors were found to be viable and relevant. Whereas the following factors, intelligence, alertness, achievement, cooperativeness, tolerance, and influence, they became relevant in a different manner across the two studies. So let's look at some of these traits in greater detail. Let's look at intelligence as the key trait. Intelligence is the intellectual ability. We are aware of that. And what does intelligence define itself in terms of? Six factors. One, any intelligent person will have a capacity for logic and reasoning. He or she would have the ability to grasp new knowledge, because one doesn't stay at the same level of intelligence. As you get new knowledge, you tend to develop greater intellectual quotient, ability to solve problems, creativity and innovation, critical thinking and planning. These are these very important aspects of intelligence or the intellectual ability of a person. I have provided here the images of four leaders: Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, Indira Nooyi, and Satya Nadella. You can see from that, two of them were college dropouts and two of them were and are highly accomplished educational background people. Now you can therefore conclude that intelligence is reflected not merely in the scholastic record but also in the practical record. It is possible for you to gain intelligence both through education as well as practice. But let's also look at the caveat. Intelligence is necessary but not a sufficient condition for sustainable leadership. Neither is the relationship between intelligence and leader accomplishment perfect and linear. Beyond a point, at times intelligence also acts as a negative parameter for success as a leader. We'll have some examples of why it is so and how it was so in respect of certain leaders. The second key trait is self-confidence. What is self-confidence? A belief that I can do these things by myself. And how does that come about? That comes about because you are aware of what you are capable of carrying out. self-awareness. That is the fundamental requirement for self-confidence. The other is self-esteem. You may be aware, but you do not possess enough of self-worth or self-esteem. And that could constrain your ability to have demonstrated self-confidence and do a few things. Then self-assurance, self-analysis, ability to analyze yourself. You are aware, but you also need to analyze yourself with reference to the opportunity and challenge you have, and also the situational context. Therefore, the self-analysis, the self-development, because you are aware that yes, I have 70% of the capability to achieve the task on hand, but I would need to develop the balance 30% skills or capabilities. So the ability to develop yourself, that is also leading to your self-confidence, self-introspection. As you keep achieving something, depending upon the level of progress and the level of accomplishment, you may introspect and try to play upon any of these other five factors. Is very important. Self-confidence is reflected in bold decisions. People, that is the leaders who are self-confident, take significantly bolder decisions than people or leaders who lack the same level of self-confidence. Some of the decisions which require a high level of self-confidence are globalization, innovation, diversification, road to recovery through turnaround. These are the four strategic decisions which a leader faces and a leader is expected to take. And a more self-confident leader would take these kinds of challenging and daunting decisions with much greater assurance. So self-confidence is an extremely important aspect of leadership. Steve Jobs is an excellent example of a self-confident leader, who of course has several other leadership traits. Self-confidence helps a leader overcome external and internal roadblocks and resistance as the leader moves through his path and tries to attain his or her goals. The third key trait is persistence. What is persistence? Doggedness. That is being at it without getting distracted and proceed on a mission with a relentless focus. So the aspects of persistence are determination. That is, I must achieve this, like I must complete the course and get good rating out of the course examination. That is determination. Conviction that yes, I must do it because I can do it. I must also do it because I believe this helps me. Similarly, a leader does something because it is not only in consonance with the strategy and the vision, but he also has conviction that this is helpful to the organization. Then dominance. If you want to be persistent, you need to be a bit dominant. You can't be self-effacing and try to be persistent. Then the drive, that is ability to push forward not only yourself but your team. That's the drive of persistence. Then focus. As I said, you should be unrelenting in your focus to be able to achieve this. And then finally, passion, which is a much used term in the context of entrepreneurship, but passion is required equally in any situation. These six determine how persistence is defined in an individual. Let us look at four examples. Somebody who is undertaking a mountaineering mission, he is goal driven, he is persistent by that. Somebody who is going down deep into the earth to explore something new, he is fearless, he is driven by that. Somebody who is traveling over the vast seas without any landmass in sight, he is undaunted by his isolation. He is undaunted by the nature's fury that could surround him at any point of time. That is the persistence of that particular individual. Then somebody who is always exploring for a new star, for a new constellation, he is or she is patient. So persistence, I would say, is an entrepreneurial trait almost, which is driven by passion. But let's also look at another caveat. Like for the other two key traits, there is a caveat here also. Persistence is a tipping factor for a leader. That is, whether you are a great leader or an ordinary leader is dependent upon how persistent you are in terms of your mission, in terms of your set of activities. But if you are so persistent that you refuse to look at what's happening, that could serve as a tripping point. You might falter because you are so persistent, dogged and dogmatic in what you think you will achieve. So while being passionately driven, a leader also needs to be sufficiently dispassionate and objective and introspective to be able to make course corrections when needed. That's very important. Then the fourth key trait is responsibility. What are the aspects of responsibility? You are accountable to yourself. Because responsibility is always packaged with authority. You can't say that others are accountable and you are not accountable. No, a good leader is always accountable to himself or herself. Second, integrity. The leader must display a high level of integrity, not for showcasing purpose, but because the leader genuinely believes in that. Then ethics, that is the larger set of moral values which guide a person. Values, a sum total of what the business would stand for, what he or she as a leader would stand for. Commitment, that is you are committed to a cause. When Mahatma Gandhi went on a fast, he went on because he was not only responsible and accountable to what he was saying, but he was also committed to the cause and was undergoing self-sacrifice to be able to demonstrate to the people at large that he believes and holds himself accountability to the cause he is espousing. Then we have ownership. So these six are very important aspects of responsibility. Let us look at the four leaders I have demonstrated here. Mahatma Gandhi, I already mentioned. Lal Bahadur Shastri, he was a very simple Prime Minister of India who led the nation through his role modeling of simplicity and authenticity. Then we have G.R.D. Tata, who believed in trusteeship and led a conglomerate to greater heights. Then Azim Premji, by virtue of his concern for education and other charitable activities, while he built a huge conglomerate of IT and a few other industrial activities, he also has been donating very liberally to the cause of charity, more particularly education. So there is a value-driven responsibility that could be exhibited by good leaders. Responsibility in all its hues is one of the most important aspects of leadership today, because there is materialism all around. There is a get-quick attitude all around. So genuine leadership, authentic leadership requires responsibility as defined herein to be able to perform as a truly well-rounded leader. Only because these have been under threat, investors and the systems are looking at ESG investing. That is a leader who also has concern for environment, social responsibility and corporate governance. But if a leader has got these values intrinsic and inherent in him or her, naturally, the ESG methodology and more also would come through his leadership capability. The other key trait is sociability. A leader cannot sit in an ivory tower. A leader cannot distance himself or be distanced by others in the day-to-day or even strategic interactions. So sociability is an extremely important aspect of leadership. What does sociability mean? Friendliness. People should be able to approach you. Extraversion, that is oriented towards other people. Be courteous, caring in your approach. Be collaborative. Should not think that my job is to compete with everybody and be ahead of them. No, that is not the one. You should be able to understand the capabilities of other people and see how you and the other people can collaborate to make things happen in a much better fashion. Empathy, which is not sympathy, empathy, that is ability to understand the position from which the other person is coming from, the circumstances that are driving his responses, and see what you can do as a leader to help that person. And these things will happen when you are sensitive to the environment, sensitive to the people. A sociable leader exerts a very salubrious and harmonious impact on the organization which he is leading. Team also feels very comfortable, cared for, and they also exhibit similar traits when they deal with each other as well as with other departments and other stakeholders. Sociability, however, does not mean any dilution of determination or task orientation when such influence is required. Sociability doesn't mean laissez-faire as far as corporate leadership is concerned. Sociability is a way of making one's presence felt through harmony and unitary purpose along with the participants. These four images tell us how these animals are highly sociable and friendly animals, which demonstrate a lot of togetherness, be it penguins, dolphins, orcas or pigeons. You will find some level of satisfaction when you see them functioning as friendly groups, and they are also not afraid of you. They are willing to come to you despite you being the humans. and interact with us. This is a very interesting demonstration of sociability. More recent studies also haven't taken place after Stockdale. More recent studies up to 2017 have taken place, which talk about other traits. So I'll talk about a few other traits here: cognitive ability, extroversion, conscientiousness, emotional stability, openness, agreeableness, motivation, social intelligence, self-monitoring, emotional intelligence, problem solving. These are the important aspects of the new theory of expanded traits. Social intelligence and emotional intelligence look similar, but they have certain overlaps and interconnectivity, along with certain differences and the scale at which these are applied. Let's look at some of these aspects a little more, particularly emotional intelligence, social intelligence. We discussed in an earlier discussion how emotional intelligence began appearing as an important leadership trait. So what are emotions? Emotions are the inner feelings we get when we encounter a particular thing or an activity. It is also a heartfelt way of responding to certain situations. So it is an affective domain. It is all about human feelings about life. And when we say life, it includes work as well as personal life. Then you have got intelligence, which is the cognitive domain. Emotions belong to the affective domain, whereas intelligence belongs to the cognitive domain. That is the ability to recognize, ability to be logical and rational. Intelligence is the human ability to process information. So emotions are the set of feelings we have about life. But intelligence is the ability to process information. When we combine these two aspects, we get emotional intelligence, which is the ability to feel, perceive, evaluate, and express emotions. This is the ability to think and act on one's own and others' emotions for mutual emotional synergy. So if you are simply emotional, it is unlikely that you will be able to develop a collaborative relationship. If you are only intelligent, you are likely to be seen as robotic, very analytical, probably cool-headed, objective, dispassionate, but you may not be able to get the kind of relationship which a leader would need to get. But an emotionally intelligent person would be able to create that framework of intelligent as well as emotional relationship. Therefore, we can say that emotional intelligence is the ability of a person to understand one's own and others' feelings, thoughts, behaviors, and actions appropriately, and also respond equally appropriately. As a leadership trait, emotional intelligence comes into play more in one-on-one and small group interactions. Let's look at what social intelligence is. Social intelligence, I would say, is the broader canopy of emotional intelligence. When you have larger social interactions and a greater array of human feelings are involved, emotional intelligence transcends itself into social intelligence. So we have on one side emotional intelligence, which is the feelings and empathy, as we discussed last time. Then we also have the social competence, that is, in large groups you should have the ability to communicate, you should be able to manage conflicts, you must be able to generate collaboration. These things are done more easily in small group interactions just with emotional intelligence. But you need social competence to be able to do these three things in a larger social setting. Now, when you combine emotional intelligence and social competence, you get social intelligence, which is cohesive social grouping leadership strength. So emotional intelligence, which extrapolates itself into social intelligence, is extremely important for leaders to make their mark. Social intelligence is a broader term that denotes the ability of a person, one, to understand one's own and others' feelings, thoughts, behaviors, and actions appropriately, and also respond equally appropriately, which is exactly the definition of emotional intelligence, but also communicate effectively with small and large groups to coalesce them based on emotional empathy. So an organization is driven by a combination of emotional intelligence and social intelligence. There are also, as I said, many other weak traits. Some weak traits, let's look at it. Adjustment, that is trying to adjust to each other. Conservatism, being very cautious. Motivation, ability to motivate and ability to get motivated. Task knowledge, lot of interest in the jobs we need to do. Masculinity, trying to be very bold and brash. Diplomacy, trying to be self-effacing where required, trying to be difficult. The same person playing good cop and bad cop. These are the weak traits. Some leaders may possess these things, and in some cases you may be successful with these traits as well. But necessarily, these are not the traits one must have at all times. So weak traits can be seen as those traits which run counter to certain other strongly correlated leadership traits. For example, should we look at adjustment or alignment? Certainly, we should look at alignment. And how does alignment come about? When you are able to demonstrate your accountability, when you demonstrate your determination, when you demonstrate your intellectual ability, when you demonstrate your social intelligence, then alignment comes between leader and the followers. On the other hand, if you try to use your authority or enter into a kind of quid pro quo for an adjustment, that is not a good trait. Similarly, should we be conservative or should we be realistic? Obviously, we should be realistic. Should we be getting motivated or motivating others? Should we have only task knowledge or should we have task orientation? Which is more important? Should you look at masculinity as the way of getting things done or look at gender diversity, understanding and utilizing the capabilities of different genders? Should you look at diplomacy or come across as an authentic person? You may have opposing positions of negotiation, but as long as you are authentic about what you are saying and what you want from the other party, you need not necessarily be diplomatic to win that discussion round. You will can be authentic and also achieve a win-win collaboration. So these are the weak traits which need to be adjusted from that weakness, or the traits which need to be modified from that weakness, and also key traits which we discussed earlier. But the issue with the trait theory is that there are so many traits that they get at times confusing, and also how they relate to actual leadership performance has not been fully established and empirically demonstrated. Therefore, some people have come about a personality-based trait theory, which says that yes, apart from all these traits, proliferation of these traits, we also have some basic five personality types or personality characteristics which determine leadership. This is the big five-factor study of personality, which is an empirical approach to achieve a definition of leadership based very much on psychological leadership studies. Neuroticism. Every person tends to be neurotic. Neurotic not to be seen in a wrong sense. Neurotic in the sense of having certain feelings which predetermine our psychological positions. People tend to be depressed, anxious, insecure, exuberant, vulnerable, hostile, that is one part. Extroversion, the tendency to be sociable, assertive, and to have positive energy. We feel all the while such people when we meet them. Openness, the tendency to be informed, creative, insightful, and curious, that is the openness. Then agreeableness, you tend to be accepting, conforming, trusting, and nurturing. As a result, you are also agreeable. You have a feeling of agreeableness that is generated in other people because you yourself have that agreeableness as part of your leadership psychology. Then, of course, this important and tongue-twisting conscientiousness, the tendency to be thorough, organized, controlled, dependable, and decisive. These factors are also referred to in alternate terms. Neuroticism is referred to as emotional stability. Extroversion is referred to as urgency. Openness is referred to as culture. Agreeableness as likability. And conscientiousness as dependability. These are the five factors which determine the personality of a person. So what is the dominant impact of these personality traits? A major meta-analysis of 78 leadership and personality studies published between 1967 and 1998 was conducted by the authors whom I mentioned, the researchers. The study found a strong correlation between the big five traits and leadership. Based on their studies, they found that extroversion was most strongly associated with leadership. Clearly, being externally oriented and engaged helps leaders be effective. Secondly, dependability ranks next. Being dependable helps a leader be effective. Third, openness, a marker of culture, is a third ranked, and a leader who practices open culture would be an effective leader. Neuroticism, which reflects emotional stability. We talked in the definition the negative aspects of emotional stability, is another marker for effective leadership. And fifthly, agreeableness, which is trying to be good to everybody and wanting to be good with everybody. That need not necessarily be the most dominant impact full characteristic. In fact, it is the lowest in terms of leadership effectiveness. The five-factor personality framework obviously simplifies the leadership trait analysis, and it has a simpler framework to understand leadership effectiveness. Logically as well as intuitively, these five factors are present to one degree or the other in successful leaders. But we must also not think that these five would be sufficient for understanding leadership in all its depth and breadth. How does a leader become dependable? There are several factors which make a leader dependable. Highly correlated with overall job performance, that is, if a leader is able to achieve what he or she said she would achieve through the kind of strategies and activities laid out, then it highly correlates with dependable behavior. If task performance is good, dependable leader. Organizational citizen behavior, that is, your collaborative, you are communicative, you are caring, you are responsible and accountable, then highly correlated. On the other hand, if there is counterproductive or negative work behavior, a leader is unlikely to be seen as dependable leader. The point about trait theory, despite the vast canvas it covers, its conclusions appear somewhat deceptively commonplace or intuitive. They are too much very well known for us to attribute very specifically to leaders, because behind each trait there is a lot of science and there is a lot of art, there is a lot of knowledge, there is a lot of experience. So the words, the phrases used get the real deep meaning only when these four aspects come to the fore, when the traits are being talked about or when the traits are being experienced. That's the challenge which trait theory has in practice. So a leader gets his or her strengths with the traits, but what are the kinds of traits one must really look at? A leader should look at traits which are stable over time, not transient traits. Stable traits which result in consistently high performance, and stable high performance traits which need to be reinforced. So stability, then performance, and then reinforcement of the traits is a three-step process. Then you will get continuously escalating, increasing leadership strength. This is the body of literature that has come about in 2000s. So discovery of strengths, leveraging them for performance, and developing them further is in itself a leadership trait. And that is a strength which gets reflected in the self-awareness. The key traits which we have discussed in the beginning of this lecture are very important traits. So what are the characteristic features of trait approach? The theory is very simple and straightforward. It focuses on the leader rather than on the teams, organizations or ecosystem. It tells us that you should look towards the leader so that he or she is able to manage and lead you. It is not process oriented. It doesn't distinguish between manufacturing industry or electronics industry or product industry and service industry. It also does not wait for results for intervention. It is not prescriptive. It is not saying that these are the traits you must have. It only says that based on the available body of literature of successful leadership or unsuccessful leadership, these are the strong traits one must have and these are the weak traits one could have. It is, however, retrospective, because based on the studies that have taken place, there is some correlation between the positive leadership traits and effective leadership. So the retrospective nature of this trait theory does provide you some validated mechanism to believe that if I were to be this kind of a leader with these kinds of traits, I am likely to have success in the situation that I am facing. So the trait theory lets organizations as well as teams seek and follow leaders who possess certain traits. Leaders and traits therefore are central to leadership processes. What is the appeal of trait approach? It is a guide for self-selection. You have a literature on the successful traits, key traits, and you know what you are if you have self-awareness. Then you try to understand, based on the situation you are facing, the required leader traits. Then it also helps organizations to have a guided leadership selection. Organizations can think that my situation, our situation, requires these kinds of leadership traits, and therefore look for leaders who provide those kinds of leadership traits. It also helps institutionalize leadership and management selection processes. That is how you move from executive to manager level, and manager level to leader level, and from leader level to apex leader level, could be based on the filter of traits you may have. And when such traits also include traits of values, ethics, integrity, persistence, determination, intelligence, etc., it is very easy to believe that if you have these leaders, I should assure a development path for the potential people. And we can also, based on the traits, groom managers. If already they are displaying these kinds of traits, it behoves the organization to develop these traits further and make managers evolve into leaders and leaders into more effective leaders. And as a result of having a kind of focus, normalization and standardization on the spectrum of traits, you are building a broad leadership bench that is available in the organization. So the traits, the selection criteria, assessment tools, 360 degree frameworks, the development methods, accountability methods, reward mechanisms, they all could be interrelated so that there is an effective leadership culture which is based around traits. From the viewpoint of a person, be it the individual, be it the manager or the leader, it also helps self-analysis and self-development. One can analyze one's own traits, understand one's own strengths and weaknesses. I possess these traits, but the impact in the workplace or in the marketplace is not exactly what I was looking for. So you understand, based on your introspection, the relevance of the strengths and weaknesses. You appreciate how important these traits are in the eyes of the other people. Fourthly, you understand with trait assessment the gaps that are requiring to be bridged still. And the traits can be used for coaching and mentoring yourself as well as others. So it's a perfect guide for self-analysis and self-development. When trait theory is used as a development tool, there are certain requirements as well. The incumbents as well as the leader must be open and introspective. As we saw earlier, traits cannot be imposed on any particular leader or on any particular situation. They have to be contextually relevant and must be seen as providing performance. Therefore, you need to be open and introspective when you are using traits as a development tool. Just because I possess these traits, I cannot impose those traits on the manager who is going to lead the organization 10 years down the road. Who knows the situation 10 years down the road? What kind of technologies would be there? What kind of networking would be there? What kind of globalization or protectionism would be there? So you need to enable the person understand the traits as successful retrospectively and contemporaneously, but also provide the bandwidth for the individual to acquire or reinforce the traits as he or she moves along. That's extremely important for personal development. As I said, the trait approach has got several strengths: simple and elegant to understand and practice, doesn't require complex frameworks and constructs to absorb and implement. It resonates very well with the human approach to typify people, to label people. So it is very easy to say that he's a compassionate leader, he is a task-oriented leader, he is an intelligent leader, he is a sociable leader. So it resonates very well with our human approach to anchor certain concepts and leaders together. It is also backed, all said and done, by over a century of meta-analysis comprising individual studies as well as group studies, and therefore there is an unmatched breadth and depth of data and interpretations. By focusing on traits, the theory provides a pathway for followers. Followers have seen leaders with these traits being successful and also being rewarded. So they believe that having those traits would be a worthwhile path to follow. Need not necessarily be the only path to follow, but a worthwhile path to follow. It also enables benchmarking of individual and organizational competencies vis-a-vis industry standards, national and international. When you see leaders leading other organizations to greater success or to greater failure, you will understand that yes, probably this level of leadership, this type of leadership is one of the causes for the great or not so great performance of that company. So you can also benchmark yourself based on the trait approach that you are willing to put in practice in your organization. It is therefore important to understand the strengths of the trait approach and also relate it to the diversity of leaders. So you should not make trait approach a singular approach of very limited traits. You should also look at the diversity of leaders you have and then match the trait approach to the leadership diversity. So in that context, you should be open to understand the critical records of trait approach. Trait approach did have its criticisms. One, too many traits. Of course, few are more popular than the other. We have seen how six traits have been popular across two generations of studies. But the sheer variety of traits and their meanings could cause confusion because traits are loosely defined. And to get the exact definition is a challenge. And a more exact definition relating to the leader and the firm and the industry and even the national culture is even a greater confusion. So there is a lot of ambiguity which is built into the trait theory by definition. It is both by design and default. But we must understand, therefore, to how the traits can be fine-tuned and honed to more precise definitions within our own leadership system, within our own industrial system. That is the one way in which we can mitigate the critical deficiency in the trait approach. The research of last 100 years has only served to balloon the canvas of traits. Clarity was provided to some traits, but also added a lot of ambiguities to various other traits. And it is bereft of situations. A trait is a trait and is supposed to be juxtaposed irrespective of the situations in the leadership context. That is the third weakness. And there is never a guarantee that generalized traits can deliver specific responses on the part of the leaders, also specific competitiveness on the part of the companies. So traits and the broader personalities of leaders need not necessarily be correlated. And the broader personality may refuse to get expressed in terms of the traits which you are trying to pursue. And what is a good trait for you could be a non so good trait for you. We already discussed, for example, where persistence stops being a tipping point, favorable tipping point, and could start beginning a unfavorable tripping point for leaders. Similarly, similar things could be applicable in respect of others, like excessive intelligence, trying to be very number savvy, trying to be very analytical, could actually slow down the process. Therefore, there is always this subjectivity as to what is the line that is appropriate in respect of each of these traits so that success is better assured within that boundary rather than out of that boundary. And the research available does not throw light on that. It also will constrain innovation. If someone says to us that you please follow only these traits as your guideposts for leadership in the organization, your own creativity and innovation and your own ability to develop capabilities which are more related to the firm, yourself and the industry, they become constrained. Therefore, innovation in leadership is definitely constrained by the trait theory, because traits are psychological parameters. They need not necessarily provide the complete assurance. As we will see in other parts of the course, knowledge of the domain, ability to deploy the knowledge of the domain, even if you are not an expert, in a beneficial manner. These are all extremely important aspects of leadership. So possessing of the traits by itself does not guarantee leadership success nor organizational success. Therefore, we should take the trait approach for the goodness it brings to us, for the canvas it presents to us, and for the clarity in respect of certain key traits it gives us. And also the benefits it provides in terms of labeling the leaders to an extent, providing developmental pathways, both self-development as well as development of other people, and providing a framework for expanding the leadership bench. We should appreciate trade theory for the useful perspectives it offers for leadership, but we should also be cognizant of the pitfalls that leadership could face if trade theory is accepted and implemented blindly. So we have to utilize trade theory with caution, as every other theory, and we should keep in mind the individual, firm level, industry level and market level factors that are at play. That's extremely important. We'll illustrate these concepts with various examples. We had Microsoft, which was founded by absolutely intelligent phenomenon called Bill Gates. So he developed the company into a technology major with his desktop operating system and a few other products. He was highly intelligent, highly articulate, but his personality also had a lot of dominance. Then came, after he moved out of his full-time position, Steve Ballmer, who was second in command for Bill Gates. He was very authoritarian, very forceful, and he believed in certain ways of doing things. Then came Satya Nadella, who was a completely antithesis of Steve Ballmer in terms of openness, in terms of authenticity, in terms of listening skills, in terms of willingness to change the business models themselves. So these three leaders managed the same firm. To one degree or the other, the firm continued to grow. Of course, the exceptional growth came in Bill Gates' time. Kind of consolidation and stability came in Steve Ballmer's time. But a further expansion and adaptation to the new realities of digital technology came in Satya Nadella's time. And as I said, Microsoft became one of the top rated market capitalization companies in the US under Satya Nadella. So different leaders, different combinations of traits, different performance levels. Then we had Apple, John Sculley, who never could take Apple to any heights. Then we had Steve Jobs in version 2.0, who literally redefined Apple innovation, perfection, and consumer experience as drivers of business growth. Then we have Tim Cook, who reflected change with continuity, more of innovation, more of perfection, at the same time more of diversity, more of broader national and consumer interfaces. Again, three different leaders, three different trait profiles, and three different performance levels. Then we had IBM, again three different leaders, Gessner, Palmisano, and Rometty. Three different leaders. So if you really look at leaders and their traits and across generations of companies, you will find that the success formula could come with different types of leadership trait characteristics and bundles, but also depending on the different characteristics of environment that the companies face. Your traits should be such that you could take advantage of the changing environment, be contextually relevant for yourself and for the firm, and take on other traits which are necessary to deal with the discontinuities we face in the environment. That is extremely important. Indian situation. We had N.R. Narayan Murthy founded and ran Infosys for a long, long time with his global delivery model and interpersonal relationships, values and ethics, and being a very prestigious infotech institution in the country. These are the creditable accomplishments of N.R. Narayan Murthy. Then came Chris Gopalakrishnan. He was a more inclusive leader who ensured that the strong foundations and superstructure which NRN built were not shaken and in fact were taken forward to higher levels. Now, after the interregnum caused by Vishal Sikka and certain other disturbances, we have Salil Parekh, who is again a process-driven leader, who is redefining Infosys in the new environment. He is the first CEO, apart from Vishal, to be outside the promoter grouping. And he has done very well. The personality profiles and the leadership traits of the three leaders are different, but the company continues to grow. So is with the Tata Motors. Sumant Mulgaonkar, who worked very extensively with JRD Tata and Ratan Tata, was a technology and people man, laid the solid foundations for Tata Engineering and Locomotive Company to be telco and then to be Tata Motors. He was the pioneer as far as the indigenous vehicle introduction for the first time by any Indian automobile company is concerned in India. That was his contribution. Then came Ravikant, who drove the diversification strategy into light commercial vehicles, passengers, cars, and things like that. Now we have got Quinton Buschek, who is leading the company on a globalization pathway and managing a much larger grouping of business verticals and product verticals in Tata Motors. Again, three different leaders, three different trade clusters, and three different levels of performance. State Bank of India, highly respected public sector bank, the largest bank in India, OP Bhatt, Arundhati Bhattacharya, and Rajneesh Kumar. They again had three different ways of looking at things, three different capabilities spectra in handling the issues, and three different circumstantial pressures, and yet all of them have performed to take SBI to a consistent growth path. Overall, some traits will definitely correlate very well with the evolutionary phase of the company, and therefore there is a contextual nature of the traits. That is what we need to keep in mind. Would Chris Gopal Krishnan have been as successful as N.R. Narayan Murthy in the foundational phase of the company? While it is very difficult to second guess, one may say that may not be. Similarly, would N.R. Narayan Murthy be as effective in today's highly networked, highly competitive and a process driven by newer digital technologies? Maybe, may not be. So options differ. Sumant, with his extreme passion for indigenous development and also truck-based product development, would he have been so successful today in developing custom-driven automobiles, passenger cars, light commercial vehicles, small commercial vehicles, and heavy commercial vehicles? Doubtful. But for that period, Sumant was the best. Ravikant probably would not have done what Sumant Mulgaonkar would have done. Same applies to different. In the turbulent times which Rajneesh Kumar faced, it required decisiveness, doggedness, and steadiness to be able to coast the SBI through the challenging times of non-performing assets, insolvency, and bankruptcy code formulation, and taking companies through that successfully. That required a great level of alignment of various stakeholder interests, which Rajneesh Kumar could achieve. So we have to see the context and the traits and correlate the specific success correlations. So how do we optimize the trait approach? I would say that it has three particular requirements. One, you review the past, you simulate a future, and optimize the current. That is the way in which you can do. Because by reviewing the past, you have some heuristic analysis of what traits will work under what circumstances with what leaders. Then you imagine what kind of future that's going to be and what kind of leadership challenges the future would pose, and then reorient the current so that you lay an optimized foundation so that you could move to the future. So benefiting from the strengths and weakness of the trait theory, we can certainly use trait theory as a guidepost for leadership journey of firms and leaders. That has to go beyond the just proven traits. Therefore, consider current leader traits and performance, benchmark with industry leaders' traits and performance, simulate leader traits and outcomes as may be required in future, select optimal trait and outcome combination, and then start recalibrating based on the actual outcomes. Trait theory can be applied by all firms and all individuals and at all levels to improve their understanding of effective leadership, be it the grassroots leader, be it the grassroots leader, the manager, the leader, or the apex leader. However, it will be more successful when it is seen as a guidance framework rather than prescription framework. When it is seen as a guidepost rather than a prescriptive Magna Carta. So the need for balance is very much there when you look at trait theory. Companies could be in three different phases: startup, growth, and decline. It could be a first generation company, serial generation entrepreneurial company. In the growth phase, you can have dominant growth or competitive growth. In the decline could have been caused by our own internal causes or by external causes. We could be in single business, multi-business, as I discussed in the first lecture. Industries could be single industry, multi-industry. we could be globally networked, not networked at all, staying in only one country. Therefore, looking at all these firm business and industry, economy, national, international context, you must choose a trait combination that is useful for leaders and for leaders to be successful in their organizational missions. Therefore, finding the right balance of traits, selecting the right traits, finding the right balance with reference to the firm and the context is itself a major leadership challenge, which leaders must be well trained and well aware of. Thank you.